Hey everyone, David C. Anderson here coming at you from the Knife Center, and welcome to Knife AQ number 4. It's the series where I answer all your knife questions, big or small. Today, we're going to look at a few things like washers versus bearings, figure out the best Delica out there, look at some modern classics, and more. Let's check them out. All right, our first question today comes from commenter Johnny Solo, and he's asking, any recommendations on a non-assisted EDC knife with a button lock? Got a couple here for you. And the first, and probably one of my favorite button lock flippers on the market, is the Hogue X1 Micro Flip. It's a really cool little design. Of course, everyone's EDC is a little bit different, but I'm showing you a knife here with a under 3-inch blade, so it's really, really convenient to carry just about anywhere. And they're priced really well, especially considering they're made in America. This particular version starts at about $127 right now, which is really good. You've got aluminum handles and CPM 154 stainless steel, particle metallurgy version of 154 CM, of course. So you've got really good edge retention and really good performance in a nice, convenient package. Now, the reason I love this knife so much is it comes right down to the action of the knife. And you can hear it really in just the way it pops open. It's just very, very satisfying to flip. Sometimes button locks, with a button lock, the flipper can be a little hard to tune as well as some other things out there, but that's not the case with this knife. Really a fantastic little blade, convenient size to carry around, as I mentioned. I could do that all day. And I've probably annoyed a few people by doing just that. A really cool little knife. The factory edges on Hogues are always very good too, so it's nice and razor sharp. Got another option here, similar size, but a more budget-oriented blade. This is the CRKT BT Fighter from Brian Tai, just $45. And there's a small and a large. The large one comes with a Tanto blade, about 3.6 inches. This guy is under 3 inches with this this drop point, or no, that's a nice straight clip point there with plenty of belly to the design. And similarly, the action on this is really good. Even flicks closed quite nicely. That's one thing you might have noticed on the Hogue. You can flick close, but it stops there, and that's due to the tuning on the detent. But this guy flips open quite nicely, flips closed quite nicely as well. Materials obviously aren't as high end. You've got an 8CR13 MOV stainless steel blade, so that's roughly OS 8 in terms of performance, if you're familiar with that steel. Good solid budget option, glass reinforced nylon for the handles. That's a nice little shape. You got kind of a three finger grip plus a bit on the end there for your pinky to grab. It's a little bit on the smaller side, so like I said, there always is that bigger version. But really good action, really addicting action as well for not a lot of money. All right, our next question came to us in an email from Simon N. He says, I'm looking to source a multi-tool type whittling knife and you thought you might be a good fit. Will you be able to recommend some to me? Absolutely. First one is from Flexcut, and this is immediately what I think of as a dedicated whittling type of multi-tool. This is the Carvin Jack or Whittling Jack. What do they call this one, actually? A couple of them have different names. This one's the Pocket Jack for Carvin, but we'll make sure to link to the whole series of these down there. And what's nice about this, in addition to that nice blade here, you've got a series of gouges, which you're gonna be able to affect certain types of cuts that you can't really do with a straight edge blade. You got the inline gouge here, and these two, a gouge on the side here that's offset, so it's more of a pull or a paring type of grip. And you've also got an offset V-shaped gouge right here for putting some more distinct lines in, again, in that kind of paring, pinching type of motion. And the blade on these are really nice. They're carbon steel, and it has a full convex geometry, or not full convex, but it's convex right to zero, so it's easy to hone, and it's a really excellent geometry for carving wood. These are made in the USA. The price on this one is about $84 right now, but it's nice and solid. All these tools lock, which is nice, which some of the slip joints out there, that's something you have to be a little more careful with, but you've got that added degree of safety with these. Now, if you want something that's a little less dedicated, I would go with one of those old school slip joints. Case makes a half whittler that's good. The Stockman pattern, I always thought it was a good whittling knife pattern. But the one I'm gonna show you right now is from Boker, and this is their Congress Whittler, coming in about $79 right now. Congress, of course, meaning you've got four blades, two on each side like that. And this one's set up really nicely with a variety of blades because this is a Congress Whittler, so the blades are a little bit different from most standard Congresses out there. You've got your sheep's foot blade as well as a coping blade right here, which is a little more precise, and I really like that. The spay blade over here gives you a good belly to work with here. And then you've got the pen blade here on this side for some finer detail cuts. And of course, this would work well for EDC as well, even if you weren't gonna use it for whittling. But another really good option, and this one is German made as well. So there's a lot of history involved with that company too. Now, if you wanna get a little more adventurous, I've actually got sort of an off the wall suggestion here, but the Victorinox Electrician. This one comes in $42. And there's a lot here right out of the package, and there's a lot you can do with it afterwards as well. Of course, you've got the main blade there, good for all kinds of things, but the electrician's blade here makes a great little carving knife, actually. But that's a really nice size. It's nice and short, very easy to control precisely when you're doing carving, and you've got two edges to work with. You've got the main straight edge, as well as the wire stripper portion, is what I usually call it, that big single recurve right there, with a sharpened edge. You can use that for some scraping or any of the some other detail cuts where you might be going around a curve. You'll be able to get some different type of feel with that section of the blade. As far as the other two implements, we've got the awl right here, which of course works very well for drilling holes into wood. It's also got a sharpened edge here, which you could sharpen up to any angle you want. You can use that for scraping as well. Or you can go real crazy and modify this if you want. You could kind of get a similar profile to that that carving blade on the flex cut device there earlier. And as for the last tool, we of course have that cap lifter here at the end. And yes, out of the box, this doesn't have anything to do with whittling or carving, but that's where, like I mentioned, if you want to get a little adventurous, you could actually mod this into a chisel if you like by putting a sharpened edge up here. You can actually make either of these edges sharp if you wish. And if you're really skilled, and you can check out Felix Immler's YouTube channel for a cool mod you can do where you can actually grind this into a small gouge to kind of, again, get some of that flex cut capability into this Victorinox, which is just a really cool, kind of a cool flex, so to speak, to mod your knife out like that. And if you're gonna mod a Swiss Army knife to be the ultimate carver, I think the Electrician is absolutely the place to start. All right, our next question is from David Palmer. He says, I'm a big fan of old school folders like case knives. Can you recommend updated versions that still retain their charm and class? I see Lion Steel has some that look pretty cool. Yes, they do. And in fact, that would always kind of be my first instinct as well, would be to recommend a Lion Steel. This is their Bestman folder. Starts at a decent price for what you're getting. We're at $129 right now. And that's because the materials are very different from those classic case knives. First of all, the blade steel, M390, nice shape on this one. We've got a drop point, but there's also clip point versions, as well as two blade versions that have a Warncliffe as well. But I just picked this one up for simplicity's sake. I like that type of spear point shape there, or almost, I guess it's a drop point, not quite a spear point. We got a full flat grind with a really great edge, or really great steel for edge retention. So performance is gonna be a lot better than any of those old school case knives. The handles, of course, have some updates as well. As you can see, there are some screws here. These aren't pinned construction like old school case knives or old school slip joints, but you've also got titanium bolsters and a range of handle materials. This one is olive wood, one of my favorite materials that comes out of the from the Italian makers because it looks nice, it feels nice and warm. Yeah, it's just really cool. I think that knife definitely has that kind of old school charm while feeling a bit new, but it is more of an old school shape. So if you want a more new school shape that still has that charm, I've got another Italian option. This is the MKM Ferra, which is a Lucas Burnley design. And these actually start under 100 depending on which handle you get. This one right here is about 119 with a Santos mahogany wood, but you can get olive wood, micarta, or I believe it's titanium that you can also get. Again, M390 for the blade here, about 3 inches. And definitely a more modern shape to the blade and the handle overall, but it still has that kind of a vintagey classic vibe if they were still making that kind of knife today. Well, they are still making that kind of knife today. But it's really cool. You've got a good shape overall, nice usable blade. The action on both of these knives are quite good. You've got a nice half stop, nice snappy action, but still easy enough to open. It's not a nail breaker for sure. Also got a crowned spine along here. It's something you see a lot from the Italian folks, and that carries back into the leaf spring on the slip joint as well. It's just really cool. Now, one of the things that MKM gives you, since obviously carrying a you know, an old school style of slip joint, even the new school versions of it, there's no pocket clip. They do provide this knife, however, with a pocket sheath. And this actually has a magnetic flap right here. You see how that works? So you can actually slip this inside your pocket and fold that over. It's gonna keep it right where it needs to be so it's not floating around in your pocket, not getting dinged up or dinging other things up. And then when you need the knife, once it breaks in, it might be a little easier to actually extract the knife without pulling the sheath out of your pocket. But of course, it's super easy to just pull the whole sheath out and grab the knife. Now, if you like that sheath but would rather have that lion steel, you're in luck, because MKM actually does sell this sheath separately. Actually, we sell it for MKM. You can find it on our site. And it's gonna fit pretty much any old school slip joint, except for the really small ones. They might be a little too much or too small that might slide out. But it's gonna fit a lot of stuff out there, including this Bestman right here. Yeah, these come in at about 25 bucks right now, so it's not too bad of a price. If you don't want one of these new school slip joints, if you've got one of your old favorites, but you don't really like to carry it too much because, you know, it bangs around in your pocket, it's not as convenient, really easy upgrade to throw in. All right, our next question is from Russell Neal. He says, I'd be interested in learning more about pivot systems. I'm just getting into appreciating premium knives and honestly don't know the difference between washers and bearings or maybe some other systems for great action. Good question. So basically, as you get more expensive, you tend to see more premium, quote unquote pivots, for whatever that means. Nylon washers are always kind of seen as the bottom end, and you'll start to see upgrades into phosphor bronze, and then eventually you'll start to see those ball bearings in the pivots. And for most people, it's all about the action, and ball bearing pivot equipped knives tend to be the knives that come with the best action. That's a little bit of a simplification, but basically the reason they achieve that is because those pivots are so very low friction. There's not a lot of resistance when you flip a knife and you actually break that detent. It's gonna let the blade flick the rest of the way open, even on larger blades like on this Hinderer XM24. Now, sometimes you'll see some proprietary names like IKBS, which CRKT uses, and a few others, or KVT bearings from Kershaw and ZT. They're just trade names. They're essentially the same type of things, although, you know, there may be a few little things different about the way they execute them, but they're not either better or worse than any other system out there. Now, despite the action, the benefits when it comes to the action, there are some disadvantages to ball bearings, and that comes in the, we'll say, the cleanliness department. Especially on these open systems, you've got exposed ball bearings, they are more susceptible to things like dirt or grime, grit getting in there and gumming up the action a little bit, which is why you'll see on a lot of tactical or combat style of knives, they'll actually stick with phosphor bronze instead of those pivots. And in fact, Rick Hinderer was very famously stuck with washers for a long, long time for exactly that reason, because he makes hard use tactical knives. Now, he has kind of, we'll say, caved to pressure a little bit, and I don't mean that in a derogatory way. Most of his new knives come equipped with what he calls the tri-way pivot system, which this knife also does have. And what that means is, out of the box, it's got bearings, but he's also got Teflon and bronze washers in the package, so you can switch those out, get that different feel and that different performance factor. Now, of course, this is a great knife, this XM24, but it is quite expensive. It's about, I think it's around $600 right now. If you want something more affordable, the Steel Wheel Modus is a great example of what a manufacturer who knows what they're doing and knows how to tune them. It shows what they can do with a phosphor bronze pivot, because there's no bearings in this Modus, but the action still flips open quite nicely. You've got a really compelling package here for about 50 bucks. D2 blade steel, really cool shape on this Modus. FRN type of handles, aluminum backspacer. They've got several knives in that price range with this type of construction if you don't like this particular shape. But in terms of the some of the best action out there with a bronze washer, I think these guys are the way to go. All right, our next question comes from Blues Ted SRT4. And he says, question, the Buck 110 was introduced in 1964, a classic. Buck makes other folders, but the 110 remains the same 50 plus years later. Of the current modern production knife companies, which of their knives has the best chance to become an unchanged classic still being sold in 50 years? I loved this question. I had to think about it a little bit because I'm sure there's some really good candidates out there, and I'd love to hear you guys let us know in the comments what your thoughts on this are. but I've got to go with the Kershaw Leak. Fantastic model. I think it was introduced, I don't have the date in front of me, but it was somewhere in the 90s, I'm pretty sure. Really cool, and even though there's a bunch of variants out there today, just like with the Buck 110, there's a bunch of variants of that. The original version, or the original vision for this knife is still going strong. This is just the standard 1660 Kershaw Leak. Sell price about $45, made in the USA. Really cool design. And the reason I got to pick this is, of all the knives that we carry, of all the knives that have been bought by Knife Center employees, I think most of the people in this building have owned a Leak or two at one time or another. I've owned, in fact, several myself. This is a really popular knife because it's a really useful shape. They're affordable, they're nice and slim, easy to carry. And you've got really good materials with this base version. 14C28N stainless steel, makes for really good edge retention on the budget side of things, a really fine edge, stainless steel frame lock. And if you want to get fancier, there's liner lock versions, there's upgraded blade steels, upgraded handles. The sky's the limit. Like I said, I think we've got almost 30 different variants on the site right now. Really cool, and I don't see the standard version of the Leak going away anytime soon, so that is my pick for this question. Let us know your picks in the comments. All right, our last question today comes from Tyler Experience. He says, Mr. Anderson, what Spyderco Delica is best? Lots of different options on the website. First of all, I have to say thank you for spelling my last name right. Most people spell it S-O-N. I am Norwegian, so it's an S-E-N. Thanks for getting that right, Tyler. And if you'd asked me a month ago, hands down, I would have said our Knife Center exclusive Delica with Pakowood handles and a laminated HAP 40 blade. I love this makeup of this knife. It has a very different feel than most other Delicas with that nice stabilized wood material there, so you don't have to worry about it shrinking or cracking, but you get kind of an old school modern vibe. I don't know, which one's your favorite between the MKM or that Spyderco? Let us know in the comments. It's a great knife. That HAP 40, really good edge retention. It's a powder metallurgy steel, but it's not stainless. So eventually that edge before the stainless laminated sides take over is gonna patina a little bit. And that's gonna look really good next to those Pakowood handles. Price on these right now, we're in the, I think the 150-ish range. About 156 right now. That would have been my answer about a month ago, but right now I am really vibing on the new K390 Delicas. I just love this version of the knife. Decently affordable here too. It's not as cheap as the VG10 versions, but it comes in about 115, and the performance here is absolutely out of this world. K390 has some phenomenal edge retention, not stainless as well, so you will get some patina here. But it's paired with the base FRN handle scales, which means you're getting the heart of a supercar in an economy car body. So it really does put your dollars where it counts in terms of the performance where you can get that you can get with this knife. And it's the Delica. It's a great all-around recommendation. A lot of folks, if they've come up to me and they just need a recommendation for a knife, but they don't really know much more than that, I usually go with the Delica. Because it's a great blade length, you're under 3 inches, full flat grind, you've got excellent slicing capabilities, you've got 4-position pocket clip, a mid-mounted back lock, and that opening hole. All those things together mean this is an ambidextrous knife, so I don't need to know what their dominant hand is, and it just gets everything done and the details are done right. But anyway, that's my pick for my favorite Delica. You guys let me know your favorites down in the comments. I think we've got a bunch. Just like that Kershaw, we've got about 30 Delicas on the site right now, so certainly a lot to wade through, but those two are my favorites. And that's it for Knife AQ number 4. Let me know what you thought of my answers. Let me know if you've got some other answers down in the comments. And if you want to have the chance to get one of your questions featured in the next Knife AQ, make sure to leave them in the comments section below. Meantime, if you want to get your hands on any of these great knives, we'll leave links in the description to take you over to KnifeCenter.com. And while you're over there, make sure you sign up for our Knife Rewards program, because if you're going to buy a knife, you might as well earn some free money for your next one while you're at it. I'm David C. Anderson from the Knife Center, signing off. See you all next time.